Hundreds of African migrants are protesting the country's refusal to grant them transit visas to travel to the United States or Canada, where they want to apply for asylum. For months, thousands of migrants from countries as far away as Angola, Eritrea, Liberia, and the Democratic Republic of Congo have been forced by the Mexican government to stay in the southern state of Chiapas on the Guatemalan border in a permanent state of limbo. Many of the migrants have been sleeping in tent cities, cooking on the streets, and bathing their children in buckets without the promise of shelter, food, or work permits. With President Trump's new restrictions on asylum seekers, including the Remain in Mexico policy, thousands of other African migrants are also stuck at the U.S.-Mexico border.
These conditions have sparked protests in Chiapas, where hundreds of African migrants have been demonstrating outside an immigration office and detention center in Tapachula since mid-August. Many of the protesters have been met with violent repression from Mexican federal police and the National Guard. This is one of the African
migrants. Hello, family. Welcome to African Esquire TV. I'm your host, Tierney Cherie. Before I get started, if you haven't already, please subscribe to AfricanEsquireTV.com. That is where I post my content before I post it to YouTube, and that is where I will also share updates with everyone. So we're going to talk about a subject that I was not aware of until recently, and that is this crisis that's happening. It's a really not reported on crisis. No one's really been talking about it, but I've seen the story pop on Democracy Now! .com, and I thought it was something that should be shared. That is the fact that there is a crisis going on in Mexico where Africans who were trying to get to the United States and Canada legally by applying for visas have been denied visas, and they're being basically stranded inside of a certain part of Mexico without access to food, shelter, and basic living necessities. So I'm going to read part of this story, and again, you can watch the full video from Democracy Now! I will post the full video on my YouTube and on my website page, and I'm going to read just a part of this article. So, hundreds of African migrants in Mexico are protesting the country's refusal to grant them transit visas to the United States or Canada, where they will want to apply for asylum. For months, thousands of African migrants have been forced by the Mexican government to stay in the southern state of Chiapas on the Guatemalan border. Many of them have been sleeping in tent cities, cooking on the streets, and bathing their children in buckets without the promise of shelter, food, or work permits. The long waits for African migrants began in June when it was reported that the Mexican immigration authorities were ignoring transit visa requests by African and Haitian migrants to legally cross the border through Mexico. For African migrants, the journey to Mexico often takes months as they cross the ocean to reach South America and then embark on a dangerous trek through the Colombian jungle and multiple Central American borders. And I want to just read a quote from one of the African migrants. He stated, "The police are beating all of the people. From the beginning, there was no violence, but the guard hits people with their shields. They are beating all of the Africans. They are beating children. They are beating all the people here. They don't want to help us. They are saying that they don't want any problems with us, but they are the ones who started beating people. They are insulting people. The military and the federal police threw tear gas at us. I don't know what we are going to do. We don't have good conditions here. We don't have a place to be. We need help. We need help getting out of here. There are comrades in the hospital beaten with a police shield in the head. We are all human beings here. People are mistreated here every day, and there they are abusing Africans. They don't want us here. If you don't want us here, then give us a visa to get out. We don't want to be in Mexico, and we cannot be forced to stay in Mexico." So just to, you know, break this down. So again, every single year, the United States takes a certain number of asylum seekers into the United States. And asylum meaning there's some type of crisis going on, or you're under some type of direct threat by way of living in whatever country you're in. So it could be something, for example, like an ethnic cleansing, and you're trying to get to a country to get asylum, or there's just murders going on and they're targeting people. These are things that you might try to apply for asylum to get to a country that's safer. Now, a lot of people have been applying to go to Europe, and obviously Europe has been cracking down on these people. And a lot of this is kind of an offshoot of the fact that the Europeans have been cutting down on how many migrants they're willing to take. Because if you don't know, not only asylum seekers go to Europe, but a lot of Africans have been crossing the Atlantic Ocean to get to Europe without, you know, illegally, without getting papers. And that's a big crisis to them because they feel like, hey, you're basically coming into our countries and you're going to take over everything that we have. Now, the United States, at the same time, has been really strict on who they're trying to grant asylum to, especially under the Trump administration. However, the United States does still take some people if you're applying from different countries. So if you're applying from Mexico, for example, they might take you. And that's basically the hope that these Africans are hoping that, okay, well, I can't get asylum from, let's say, Kenya. I can't get asylum directly from Somalia or wherever. So maybe if I go to Mexico, then I'll be able to get asylum because there's not as many people who are under direct threat who can get asylum from there. The problem is that, as we all know, the United States President Donald Trump, he has been cutting down on immigration by pressuring Mexico to be more stringent in who they let get through. So even if you're trying to legally get through, the Mexicans basically have been stepping up their force against people, and especially against African people. And this really drives home a point that I've made on this channel a number of times, is that wherever you go in the world, if you are African, you're going to be treated the worst. We know that they're treating Mexicans trying to cross the border into the U.S. Horribly. Now, we know that Africans who are trying to legally get asylum to the U.S. are not even having their applications read, Africans and Haitians. And don't think that it's a coincidence that it's Africans and Haitians. You know, there are other people trying to get asylum throughout the Latin America, trust me. So why is it that particularly Africans and Haitians are the ones who are getting their visas denied? And we know Haitians are the blacker continent of the Caribbean continents. And obviously Africans are the blacker people, right? And so both countries, both African and Haitians are facing that type of discrimination where other people are not facing that type of discrimination. This is proof that no matter where you are in the world, you know, a lot of people say it's just the United States that's racist, or it's just certain parts of the U.S., just the South or whatever. It's not just the United States problem. It's not just the Southern United States problem. It's not just the South African problem. This is a global issue that racism is going to exist wherever African people go. So the fact that they had to go all the way through South America, if you know the history of South America, you know that that racism is very well intact in South America. And similar to how there was slavery in the U.S., there was also slavery throughout all of Latin America. That's why a lot of Latin American people are either black or darker skin, and you can see their black features. So those same people have to deal with discrimination, and that while certain countries like Brazil, for example, had a campaign to actually whiten their population to try to get it to not look black, you could still see a lot of the African features inside of people, even though there was an intentional effort to dilute the African ethnicities of the populations inside of those countries. At the same time, more and more African Americans are starting to protest immigration from not just people who are, let's say, Latino, but any type of immigration from Africans or anyone. And for this reason, I think it's very important for us to understand why are so many people trying to get into the United States. And the thing is, it's actually increased in recent years from what it used to be. A lot more people are trying to get into the United States. And just to let you know, it's not because, you know, they love America so much. It's because of the policies of America, as well as Europe and China, have been excluding these people. So just as a reminder, and I've read this Honest Accounts report before, but I just wanted to scroll through a few of the statistics to give you an idea. It says, this link will be in the description, but this is from Honest Accounts, who does data and looks up information on the amount of money that is paid in foreign aid, and also the amount of money that the United States gets back by that foreign aid that's supposed to be helping the countries, but actually is done in such a way that it's actually benefiting the U.S. So this is a just a report. It says, Africa is not poor. While many of the people in African countries live in poverty, the continent has considerable wealth. A key problem is that the rest of the world, particularly Western countries, are extracting far more than they send back. Meanwhile, they are pushing economic models that fuel poverty and inequality, often in alliance with the African elites. So this is what we talk about a lot on this channel. Whenever you look at colonialism, neocolonialism to be more particular, the setup is that you'll have African elites, people who are in government, people who have access to certain things that the other people don't have access to, and you'll have these Western countries talking with these elites, working out deals with these elites in order to get access to natural resources, access to land, access to oil, access to everything that drives the economies of the entire world. And because these elites do not care for the people, and because they are more individually minded, they are more capitalist in their approach, they do not care about the fact that this money should be going to the population. They do not care about the fact that, hey, we have oil, we have gold, we have cobalt, we have diamonds, we have all these things. This is not something that I should be capitalizing on as an individual. This is something that everyone should be capitalizing on. They don't care about that. So they're willing to sell out to the U.S., to Europe, to China, because the fact that they have no allegiance to the people. Now, it goes on to say, Africa is generating large amounts of wealth, and in some ways is booming. For example, the largest 500 African countries recorded a combined turnover of $698 billion in 2014. Oof. In 2015, African countries exported $232 billion worth of minerals and oil to the rest of the world. Just let that soak in. You know, this is the poorest continent. This is people in poverty. These are people that are seeking asylum. $232 billion worth of minerals and oil come from the countries of the same people who are trying to escape their country because there's no money, and there's no jobs, there's no way for them to get money for their family. Let that soak in. That doesn't make sense. It's asinine. So, just moving on, the value of mineral reserves in the ground is, of course, even larger. South Africa's potential mineral wealth is estimated to be around $2.5 trillion, while the untapped mineral reserves of the Democratic Republic of the Congo are estimated to be an astronomical $24 trillion. Let's just, again, think about the Congo right now. The people in the Congo, I believe it is actually the poorest country in the world, the Congo. People are living off of nothing. People are starving. People are working in horrible conditions. That country has mineral reserves of $24 trillion. The people are just working these lands, and it's their land. Yet, guess who's getting the money? Guess who's getting the profit? It's not them. It's these foreign corporations, these Western corporations, who have it so set that those same people who don't, you know, just aren't aware, or they're not being told, hey, you know, this is actually something that you all should be benefiting from. This is something that you should be taking for yourselves. They are sitting on $24 trillion of mineral wealth. That is just the most ridiculous thing. And if it's not angering to you, like, I don't know how it isn't. So, these are very large numbers, but for various reasons why the majority of people in Africa do not benefit from them, and why the present mode of mineral extraction actually leads to impoverishment. So, I want to read this other part, because it talks about how corporations steal wealth. The $68 billion stolen from Africa in illicit financial flows amounts to 6.1% of the continent's entire GDP. Multinational corporations are stealing, these are these corporations that are in Africa, they're stealing $42 billion alone through trade misinvoicing, according to figures produced by the Global Financial Integrity. Previous research from the UN Economic Commission for Africa found similar figures that multinational corporations stole around $40 billion a year from African countries through trade invoicing in the decade up to 2010. Another massive problem is corporations buying concessions at falsely knockdown prices, often linked to corruption and to tax havens. In 2013, the African Progress Panel and Global Witness examined five major sales of mining rights in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, in which each deal involved firms registered in the British Virgin Islands. They found firms paid at least $1.36 billion below the market value, almost double the DRC spends each year on health and education combined. So there's one last part I want to talk about. I thought this was interesting. It says, the poverty in Africa is deeper than the World Bank publicizes. So basically, in fact, I'm just going to paraphrase this. Basically, the World Bank paraphrases poverty as being under $1.90, right? However, according to this article, 67% of Africans live on $3.10 a day. Yet that would not be considered extreme poverty because it's not under $1.90 a day. These are obviously misleading figures because if you're living off of $3.10 a day, that's very unlivable. Yet that's what 67% of Africans are living under. So I say all these things to say, to give you a picture of why people are fleeing Africa. They're not fleeing Africa because they want to be in America just because America is just this wonderful place, you know, and that's what they tell you. Oh, we just want your freedom and blah, blah, blah. That's what the news tells you why people are fleeing. The fact is, a lot of people actually love their home countries. A lot of people would rather be in their home countries, but they financially can't live there. They can't live there because the money that should be flourishing throughout their communities is actually being taken by our country. So when you have people say, oh, I'm anti-immigration, oh, I'm anti-immigrant, if you're going to criticize immigration, you cannot criticize people coming to the U.S. without criticizing neocolonialism. If you're going to try to criticize the people who are fleeing the fact that their countries are being stripped of their resources, but you're not going to criticize the country that strips their resources, you're being a hypocrite. If you really want people to leave your America alone and to stop coming into America, stop saying, huh, why is America taking so much from these people? Why are they taking so much through deals? Why are they taking so much through exploitation? Why is it that the Congo does not have access to $24 trillion in their own country? Maybe if they did, we would, you know, there wouldn't be this big crisis. So you can't just have it one way. You can't have it as, oh, you know, Europe, the U.S., you know, we're just going to flourish. We're just going to keep taking from other people. No one's going to come into our borders. No one's going to try to get in. No, these people are coming in as a direct consequence of what you have done in order to sustain your power, to sustain your economic monopoly on money that should be given to those people, on resources that belong to those people. This is the crisis that these people are facing. And honestly, anyone with half a brain who is living in these countries would try to escape it. But unfortunately, the fact is that we're taking these very dangerous trips through Europe and to the United States to try to escape something. But the truth is, the battle really should be at home, in my opinion. You know, there's no reason why these corporations should have access to your minerals. There's no reason why you should not be demanding collective ownership of these mines. Could you imagine what would happen? So we'll take a cooperative, for example. A worker cooperative is a corporation that is owned by not just one person, but it's owned by a collective. So for example, in Europe, there's a lot of companies that are not even owned by one person. They're owned by many people. All these people have a say. It's like a democracy inside of a company where people can vote in on, hey, we want to do this with this, we want to do that. They vote on the whoever's the CEO. Like, everyone has a say on what's going to happen, on what's going to happen with the money. Like, everyone has a say. It's a democracy. It's within a corporation. Could you imagine if the biggest mines inside of Congo were cooperatives, where these workers who are African all had an ownership stake in the same land that they were working? Could you imagine what that would do to completely offset the balance of power, where you couldn't come in and say, hey, we're going to take all these and we're going to pocket this and we're going to take it over here? No, you have to vote in order to be allowed to even do these types of things. Could you imagine the power that those people would have, the economic power? Every single person in Congo would be rich, period. Every person in South Africa, everyone will be able to live well above their means. So this is why we should be fighting for our home. You know, instead of fighting to get into these countries where, guess what, if you, when you get to the United States, you're going to find out you're basically being oppressed here, although not dying from starvation, albeit, you know, not to say that, oh, well, it's better, you know, to just die and blah, blah, blah. No, by all means, fight. But if you are able to get in, you're going to be being oppressed here, too. The real battle should be home. The battle should not be to try to get into the U.S., in my opinion. But regardless, I completely understand why people are fleeing and trying to get away from the countries that are being exploited and try to take, you know, part of what is actually theirs. Because if you think about it, if we're in a country that's taking from Africa, that's taking from other countries around the world, because it's not just Africa, it's also Latin America, also a lot of Asian countries. If we're in a country that's taking all that stuff, then really it's not... The money that is here, the jobs that are here, that's theirs too. It's taken from all these people around the world. Well, they also have a right to it, just like anyone else does. This idea that, no, you know, you can't, we'll take what we want from you, but you can't come in for taking it. No, that doesn't sound right. So you shouldn't be upset that they're trying to get in. But the issue is, again, with what happens with Mexico is that you're putting your fate in the hands of people who are adverse to you. The fact is, again, African people, wherever you go, as soon as you leave the continent of Africa, you are under attack because you are living inside of enemy territory. So for them, in this situation, you have people who are trying to get to the United States. They're not being allowed to apply for visas, not being allowed, like not even just having their visas denied. They're straight up not allowing them to apply for visas, which is crazy. And not only that, they're putting them inside these cities where they can't work, they can't live inside of, they don't have access to food. They're basically trying to exterminate them, in my opinion. They're trying to find whatever way they can to starve these people off so they won't be able to have any access to anything to be able to survive. This is the type of crisis that they are facing. So this is something that we should definitely... be raising our voices about. This is something that we should definitely be protesting, something that we should definitely be talking about. And particularly my Africans, my continental Africans who did come to the United States should be even louder, because all of us who did have to leave Africa to come here understand that that could easily be you who was being held at the border just trying to get your family to something where you can have some type of something to live off of, some type of job, some type of way to have happiness, you know. And all because of that, you're basically being walled in. You're not being given food, you're not being given shelter. You're basically being walled in to basically be exterminated from within. That's the situation that those people are facing. So this is something that we should definitely be talking about. It's definitely something that we should be raising awareness about. Again, I will post the full video to the Democracy Now! Video. They do a lot of good videos. If you do not follow them, I encourage you to follow them, because this is something that's alternative news. Whenever we hear about the immigration and the border, we typically see people who do not look African being represented as being the only people who are affected by this. But this is not just, you know, Latin American people, or this is not just Latinos. This is people who are African as well. And we have to, just as much as we're talking about other people, we have to talk about our own people and figure out what's going on with our people. Because, you know, they were crazy on the news talking about the fact that the U.S. was separating children from their parents. But I think it's just as egregious that Mexico is having these people put inside of these, basically walled off in these camps and not able to work, not like, what is your plan with them? You're just going to let them basically stay there until they can no longer survive? What is your plan? So this is something for us to talk about, something for us to spread awareness on. I will see you guys in the next video. I'd love to see your comments on this issue, and I'll see you guys soon.